My father was one of the first, I think the first chairman of the Institute for Nature Conservation, which became an institute for environmental education in the early 70s. And he was one of the delegates for the Netherlands to the Tbilisi conference. And this was in 1977, a very important meeting where UNEP and UNESCO together were able to get well over 100 countries and important ministers and sometimes even heads of states to recognize that environmental issues were challenging, urgent, were more than ecological and environmental issues. There also were issues that had to do with equity, economy.
The Foundation for Environmental Education came actually out of the group of experts that the Council of Europe had formed a working group to prepare themselves for the Tbilisi meeting. And those experts, 4 years after the Tbilisi conference, kept together and then decided to create the Foundation for Environmental Education. You have to understand, in the beginning, they only, so to speak, made their work due to conferences. And there's nothing wrong about conferences. But and that kept on for 6 years. But then in 1987, the French came up with the idea called the blue flag for beaches and marinas. And that was a completely new thought, because until that, in environmental questions, etc., we have always used the stick. But now the blue flag introduced also the carrot. There was a set of criteria. If a municipality fulfilled them, then they were awarded with the blue flag. So this was the first environmental award scheme, which has, we have seen a lot since. Some of our programs, the Eco School, where there's a green flag, is the same.
In Botswana in particular, 1971, we had wildlife clubs, which was actually spearheaded by the Conservation Education Unit in the Ministry of Wildlife. And then later on, this transformed into environmental education clubs and influenced policy development. And we saw this in 1992, where now environmental education was recommended as a cross-cutting curricular issue in the education system. But this also happened throughout Southern Africa, I would say, because you look at the history of environmental education in South Africa in particular, that is how they started from outdoor conservation education now to environmental education. And what is interesting is that all this development in some countries, particularly the emerging states, it also filtered into their constitutions. You go to South Africa, you'll find this in their constitution. You go to Namibia, you'll find environmental education clearly mentioned in their constitution.
Rio basically took place in 1992 in Brazil, where it was called the Earth Summit. It, I think at that time, was the largest gathering of the heads of state looking at a blueprint for the 21st century, and its landmark outcome was this Agenda 21, Agenda for the 21st Century, where environmental education had a very strong focus. I think the whole chapter, chapter 36, was devoted to environmental education and awareness. And in that, I think it drew a lot in terms of the first Stockholm Summit, when the UN community came together in 1972, and where, by the way, UNEP was established, that the Stockholm principles at that time, and it was called the UN Conference on the Human Environment, UNCHE, unlike UNCED, which was the UN Conference on Environment and Development, then followed by the World Summit on Sustainable Development, then Rio Plus 20. So we had nearly 40 years in between. So in that process, I think with education, there was a lot of, I guess, concern that the world, the way it was developing, and we had Rachel Carson, Silent Spring, a lot of these seminal things that actually led to environmental education being way high up on the agenda.
CCIANA was formed in 1995. It's a direct result of the free trade agreements between Mexico and the United States. As part of the parallel agreements, the Secretary of the environment of Canada, the United States, and Mexico decided to give seed money to start a nonprofit, an NGO, in one of the countries to work on environment. They didn't have, it wasn't really more specific than that. They decided it would have its headquarters in Mexico City because in the 90s, Mexico City was way far behind the United States and Canada in terms of organizations that worked on the environment. We have three programming areas. One is communication, one is environmental education and capacity building, and one is another area whose name is a term that we have coined because we haven't found a word that suits it, and we just call it social environmental capacity building. It's development, in Spanish it would be desarrollo socioambiental.
One of the significant milestones was the launch of our first national action plan in 1999. That was a result of a lot of advocacy to create a plan for environmental education to embed it in the formal, non-formal, informal sectors of education. And that was launched in 1999 as a result of the Australian Association for Environmental Education being very strong advocacy. And I think the next milestone would have been the success of embedding sustainability as a cross-curriculum priority in the Australian education curriculum.
By the time you got into the early 2000 period, we were doing a lot of work in rural development, we were doing work in looking at this, and the decade of education for sustainable development was announced. And it just fitted like a natural glove to us. So the first conference of the DESD was held at CE in Ahmedabad in January 15. And that was really civil society coming together from several countries and embracing this change. We then went into 2007, when we had the official UNESCO Tbilisi Plus 30 event happen. And that was the event where we really explored the relationship between environmental education and ESD. And not seeing it as competition, but seeing it as environmental education leading a larger movement, if you like, of getting several disciplines to participate in ESD.